Morning. Today we want to say the book of John, chapter 4. Chapter 4 from verse 1 to 26. The Pharisees heard that Jesus was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. When the Lord learned of this, he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he has to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about the sixth hour. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a water?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman says to him, "You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. When and where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, and did also his sons and his flocks and herds?" And Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." Verse 15, the woman says to him, "Sir, give me the water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He says to her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "Then I have no husband," she replied. Jesus says to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is you have five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. When you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, I can see that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but the Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus declared, "Believe me, woman, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know. For salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming, and now has now come, when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I who speak to you am he." today you have to see this story among the conversation between Jesus and Samaritan woman. We looked at this story many times, but then you have to look at this story again at this time. And this story teaches us so many things. Yeah, so many things. Here, Samaritan woman. Who is the Samaritan woman? This woman is like the representative of all the non-believers. This woman was not a believer of God. So Jesus was evangelizing this non-believer. And then, this is John chapter 4. In John chapter 3, then we can also see another story. Jesus was also evangelizing another man, whose name was Nicodemus. Nicodemus, he was the believer of God. He was even maybe, he was a leader, a great leader among the Jews, among the Israelites. But then Jesus was teaching him about rebirth, born again. If you want to see God, you need to be born again. Anyway, you can see John chapter 3, Nicodemus. Who was Nicodemus? Believer of God. But then even Jesus was teaching him more deeply about the life of faith. What is the true meaning to be born again? When you look at this from now, from current viewpoint, what can we see here? Nicodemus is the believer of God, Christians. And Samaritan woman, she was not a believer of God. She was Gentiles, non-believers. But then, both of them, they need to listen to the word of God. They need to really be born again. They really need the salvation from God. Even though there are many believers of God, there are many Christians are living, but if they don't really live, they don't really know the true word of God well, practically, deeply, then they need to learn more deeply. We need to teach them more deeply, correctly. And then we need to guide them, not just live with the knowledge. Knowledge, the theology, I mean, like theology. Many believers, even maybe CRE, through CRE, even in the school, that is good, I can say. Here in this country, people are teaching the faith in the school. This is great, actually. Great. Many other countries in the world, they don't teach about the faith in the school. They don't teach. But they are teaching about the life of faith in the school. That is great. Great. Very good. But then I could find some lag part in the CRE education of CRE. I could find that then they are teaching usually the knowledge only. Knowledge. Right? Knowledge. You need to memorize this one. You need to memorize all the 12 sons' names of Jacob. All the 12 disciples of Jesus. Names. Their names. You need to memorize all their names. And teaching the people with the faith, with the life of faith, how should the life of faith? But then, we need to teach them more deeply. How, why, and the purpose. And then, we need to be able to teach them how they should live, guide them. We need to be able to guide their life, how they should live with faith. The faith, the knowledge, we need to really listen to the word of God. It can come
come to our brain. We need to, we can understand the word of God with our brain. But then, it needs to come to our heart. We need to be impressed by the love of God for our life. And then we need to change our life. We need to obey the word of God, our life, through our life. The word of God, the knowledge of God, it should not be remaining as a knowledge itself. It should be our life. That's why we need to be present to maintain the word of God day and night, and try to live according to it. So I can say the problem of the believers of this world. They know the word of God. They listen to the word of God on Sundays. But do they really live according to it? Do they really know the deep meaning of the word of God? And do they really live according to the word of God? That can be the problem. So that's why we need to teach them, both of them, the believers, even we need to teach the Christians, we need to teach them again, we need to teach them more deeply, correctly, and then we also need to guide them with their life also. Prophesy again, we need to prophesy again. It has prophesied to many people, but then maybe many people, many believers of God, they forgot many words of God. And they don't really live according to the word of God. Even the Christians. But then, that's why we need to go to them again. We need to prophesy again. We need to teach them again. So, believers, Nicodemus, chapter 3. And non-believers, the Samaritan woman, all the non-believers, non-Christians. Then all of us, we need to listen to the word of God for our salvation. And we need to listen to the word of God for our salvation, for our own salvation, for your salvation. From God, from this dark world, from the punishment of God. And then today, we can focus on this woman, Samaritan woman, non-believers. How was she? She was living a very thirsty life. Was it right? She was living with water. She has to draw water every day. And then, when did she come to draw water? 6th hour. When was it? At 6th hour. This is 12 o'clock. And during the daytime. Twilight time, the same as twilight time. Israelites, Jewish time, but the same as twilight time. 6th hour. It was 12 at noon. By this time, nobody was going around at this region. Palestinian region, you know, near the Mediterranean Sea, very hot, under the hot sun, nobody was going around. From around 11, 12, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, people are usually resting at home at that time. And I know that even nowadays, in that, like, Italy and those countries, they start to walk around 5 o'clock, from 5 o'clock in the evening. And then they walk up to like 10 o'clock at night. And then they close their shop around 10 o'clock or 12 o'clock at night. And then they sleep. And then they sleep up to like 10 o'clock in the morning or 11 o'clock in the morning. This is how I heard, even nowadays. But here, this woman, when nobody was going around, this woman came out to draw water. A another husband. Why? Her life was not good. This woman's life was not good, was not clean. Many people knew about this woman. Many people knew about this woman. Why? When we read it, we know this story very well, right? This woman had five men. Five men. And this woman, she's living with the sixth man now. Why? Why was she living like that? Huh? Why? She wanted to be happy. She wanted to be happy with the love in this world. But then, maybe she was not happy with man, with man's love. She was not happy with man's love. That's why, she was trying to find the happiness. And then that's why she wanted to find the truth, the another happiness from another man. And then she changed the man again and again. But she was never happy. She was never happy. She was always thirsty. So as she has to draw water every day, then if the same, she was trying to find the happiness through the love in this world. But she was never happy. So we need to learn something from here. Huh? The love in this world, it cannot give us the true happiness for man, for mankind. Huh? Young people, please know this. Don't be tempted by the love in this world. Don't be tempted by the love in this world. The man's love or woman's love, mankind's love, it cannot give the mankind the true happiness. We need to be careful. Temptation, they can be a great temptation. Instead of giving us the true happiness, but when we have the false love or immoral love, then it can give us the great pain. Instead of giving us the happiness, it can give us the great pain through the wrong loves, false loves, immoral loves. It can destroy our life. It can destroy our families by the wrong, false loves. So I can tell you this one. Don't be tempted. You know this one. The love in this world, it cannot give us the true happiness. Instead of giving us the happiness, when we do something, when we do something wrong love, even it can destroy our life. It can give us the great pain against our life. So she was not happy. Instead of being happy, maybe she was more suffering. Huh? She was more suffering. So we need to know this. The same money can be similar. Huh? People think that when we have much money, maybe I can be happy. But then will we be really happy? Then maybe our life can be more comfortable. Yeah. Our life can be more prosperous, more convenient. But then the money cannot give us the true happiness. Huh? More thirsty. As I have more money, maybe I can be more thirsty. As I have more money, I can face more temptations. More temptations, more problems. Because of money,
people are killing each other. People are hating each other because of money. At the rich family, the children cannot grow well at the rich family. You know those? Well, because of the money, in the rich families, they are fighting. Even the brothers and sisters, they are fighting because of money, because of the shamba, land. Will they be happy? Do you think that they, when they have more land, more shamba land, do you think that then they will be truly happy? That can be also another temptation. People usually think that then, when I have much money, I can be more happy. But it's not. We need to know this. When we are young, you need to know this. Money, first temptation against mankind, against man's life is, first temptation is money. Money. If you are the Son of God, you change this stone to be bread. The first temptation against mankind is money. The second temptation is the temptation of love, especially young people. We need to be careful with this temptation of love. And when we read this kind of book, then it can give us the great lesson for our life. Even when we look at the many people in the world who are living that like immoral life and those or relationship before marriage. Nowadays so many strange things are happening in the world. So don't be tempted by that. Don't be tempted. When you start that life, your life can be like this. Your life can be like this woman. She was always thirsty. She could not find the true husband. Can you imagine? She wanted to be happy, but even she could not have any, even she could not have a true, one true husband. Will she be happy? She was. But then, to this woman, Jesus wanted to give her the living water. Were you trying to be quenched by the water in the world? But I want to give you the living water. Where you go to guide you to eternal life. I want to give you the living water. Please, drink this. So where is it? Verse 13. Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." Jesus wanted to give her this living water. So then, this woman's problems can be solved. Jesus wanted to give her the living water, which can really quench her, which can really satisfy her from his heart, for her life. So Jesus wanted to give her this living water. How? Did you think about it? How? By Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. As Jesus gave his body to the world, then Jesus wanted the living water, the living bread for our life. I want to give you my blood, I want to give you my body. So please taste my body. Please drink my blood. So then you can be saved from this miserable life. So don't be tempted by the love in the world. Don't be tempted by the money in the world. But please come to me. I will give you my body. I will give you my blood. And I want to give you the eternal life. I want to guide you to the eternal life. Please take my body. Believe in me that I guide for you. So, then this woman, she started to be wondering, curious about this one, living water. Can I get living water? But still, she could not understand what Jesus was talking about.
Verse
15. The woman says to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty again. Here to keep, have to keep coming here to draw water every day." So even, but she still could not understand Jesus' water here. But then maybe she would think that, very expensive water. Jesus said, very expensive water. Right? But Jesus said another one, verse 16. He told her, "Go call your husband and come back." Why did Jesus say to her this request? Oh, call your husband. What is this husband? Did Jesus want to see her husband? Or did Jesus want to give both of them the water? What is this husband? Verse 17. "I have no husband," she replied. What is this one? Actually, this woman was hiding her simple life. I don't have a husband. Usually the sinners, right? When somebody steals something, then what do? Usually the thieves, they don't say that I did this one. They don't say that I stole this one. They just hide. They hide. I didn't do it. So I don't have a husband. What are you talking about? What are you talking about? I don't have a husband. I have no husband, she replied. But Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say that you have no husband." Yeah. But Jesus did not rebuke her. You are lying before me. Actually, Jesus knew the truth. But then Jesus was not rebuking her. But then Jesus was trying to guide her to repent. To repent with her sins. To confess with her simple life. Jesus wanted to guide her to confess. That's how she could be really be changing from her simple life. The same, right? When we really force something, force somebody, "You did this one, you did this one, you did this one," then people are difficult to change, right? But then, if I say to somebody that, if I say to somebody that, "I know that you did this one, but do you think that it was good?" If I say to him politely, then maybe he can be very pierced with his heart. Then maybe he can confess, right? Yeah, he can confess. When I say to him, somehow, softly, it's okay. But I know that you did this one. And then maybe the person, the thief, can be very pierced. Then maybe he can really confess. And then he would not do it again. But if I force him, or if I threaten him, if if you do this, I will kill you. Would you really confess? Would you really turn away from this simple life? Maybe now he would say that I would not do it. He would say with his mouth. But then from tomorrow, he would do the same thing against another person. It cannot change. The force cannot change the people. Fundamentally, I can say. But then, with the loving heart, maybe, it can really change somebody. With a forgiving heart, or maybe it can really change somebody. So, Jesus is saying, I know the fact, verse 18, verse 17, you are right when you say that you have no husband, but verse 18, the fact is you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true. Instead of rebuking this woman, why are you hiding your sin? Why are you hiding your sinful life? Why did you lie? You don't have the five husbands, six. You don't have any husband, but I know that you had five husbands before, even now you have another man. Yeah. But Jesus was not trying to force this woman. Was not trying to rebuke this woman. But then Jesus was trying to guide her to repent from her sinful life, to realize that how this woman's life was not good. Very often. Then, verse 19, she realized that. So the woman said, verse 19, I can see that you are a prophet. Yeah, she realized that Jesus, maybe this woman, she did not know even Jesus' name now. But Jesus called Jesus, sir, you look like a prophet. How could you know my life? How could you know my life? What is it? I'm proud. Yes. You are a prophet. I know. I could realize that you are a prophet. Verse 20. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. And then suddenly, this woman is asking Jesus about worshiping God. How or where should I worship God? Isn't this strange? Why did she suddenly start to ask Jesus about worshiping God? Why did she ask Jesus about worshiping God? The woman's problem in this one. She was not really worshiping God. The purpose of her life was not in God, was not toward God. She was worshiping something else in the world. She was worshiping something else. And she was living, hoping for the love in this world. She was not really worshiping God. That's why maybe her life became so strange, following something else in the world. But then now, she wanted to really worship God correctly. And then her life can be also, what is it? Corrected. Her life could be also corrected in God. That's why she's asking Jesus, where should I worship God? How can I really worship God correctly, truly? This is important. The life, many people are living very strangely. Why? They don't really worship God correctly. Many people, they don't know how they should live correctly. And then we need to teach them the truth. How they should live before God. How they should worship God for their life. And then their life cannot be, what is it? Swayed. Should not be swayed by the simple word. Cannot be corrupted by the simple word. Cannot be affected by the simple word. We should worship God, the true God, correctly. We should know the truth, and then we should live according to the true word of God, worshiping God with our life, not worshiping any God. Not the worshiping God, the God, conceptual God, the living God. We should worship the living God, the true God for our life, not the fake God. So this woman is asking Jesus, well, who is the living God? Who is the true God? Where is the God? Is he in this mountain? So that I can worship God in this mountain? In Samaria, they have also many like temples in the mountain. But in Jerusalem, there was the temple of God, Jehovah God. And then where can I really worship God correctly? For our life of the same. After we are born again, we really need to worship God continually, correctly, continually. Don't try to, we should not be tempted to follow something else or to worship something else in the world, to worship money. To live for the money or to live for the love? We should not live for those things in the world. So, this woman is asking Jesus, where should I worship God? Prophet, please teach me. This is important for the life. After we are born again, after we met God, then we can really worship God. We should worship God truly and correctly for our life. And then our life can be different from yesterday. We can be escaping from the simple life. We can be escaping from the temptations. We can be escaping from the punishment of God against our simple life. And then we can find the true meaning for our life. We can find the true meaning. The purpose, the true purpose of our life in God, in His truth. So, I hope each one of us can realize this one. This is so important, to worship God, to come before God, to worship God, to listen to His word is very important. So that through His word we can know the truth. Of our life, truth of this world, and then we can live according to the truth, not the fake, not the corruption, not the temptation. So when we are young, if we can meet God from we are young, then it can be a great blessing. But don't turn away from that child. Don't be tempted by the world. Don't stop in the middle to worship. So where should I worship God? And then how did Jesus teach her? Jesus declared verse 21. Believe me, woman, a time is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. And you should worship God with spirit and truth. And the time will be coming. Then, either in this mountain nor in Jerusalem, even now already came, right? We are not supposed to worship God in Jerusalem. Even though this faith of Jehovah God started from Jerusalem.
It's true.
But then we don't really worship God in Jerusalem only. Right? We should worship God with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our strength.
Yeah. We should worship God
with spirit and truth, according to the truth. With the word of God, according to the truth. And then with all our heart, with all our strength, with all our mind, we need to worship God with our life. So this time will be coming. Women, a woman.
You need to realize this.
This time will be coming. So we should worship God with spirit and truth. Verse 22. You Samaritans worship what you do not know, but we worship what we do know. Yeah, the Israelites, they had the word of God, and they were really worshiping God according to the truth. That's why Jesus, that's how Jesus said this way. But, verse 23, yet a time is coming, and now has come, when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in spirit and truth. We need to worship God with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our strength. And then God can receive our heart. Even though, but then, for example, many people are coming to church, but then if they are not really focusing on God on Sundays for the worshiping time, but if they are looking at a beautiful woman, you know, even people come to church, but then instead of focusing on God, but if they are focusing on something else, that woman, if I marry her, those things we need to be careful. Our heart is fallen. Maybe Satan is there. Satan is stealing your heart, using the beauty of the world, or using the money, or worries, with worries, Satan can steal your heart. Because of the worries, people, if they cannot really do what they are supposed to do, then they are stolen by Satan. Their heart is stolen because of the worries. But because of the greedy heart. So, when we come before God, we should worship God with our spirit, with all our heart, and with the truth, according to the truth. So, this woman, as you see that Jesus said, this woman's life totally changed. Before then, her life was very, what is it, shameful life. Shameful, very shameful because of her simple life, dirty life. But then now, she could be very, what is it, proud, we can say proud. Even she started to evangelize from today, from this day. What is it, can you read? Verse 25. The woman said, I know that Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. Even here, we can find it that when the Messiah comes, he will explain the word of God clearly. The same, when the second coming of Jesus, when he comes, then he will explain to us every word of God very clearly. Not very clearly. So this woman, many people were waiting for that Christ. Christ would come to save us. Maybe, but then many people could think that then Israel, especially the Israelites, they thought that then Christ would come to this world riding on a cloud, with a glorious image from heaven, then he will save us from the Roman Empire. Political penalties.
But then Jesus came to this world not climbing on the cloud, but how did he come?
Through the manger, animal place. He was born in the animal place.
That's why Jesus was difficult to be believed. Jesus was a very shabby person. Jesus was very shabby. All of the days, very shabby. But then, inwardly, Jesus had the great glory of God. What Jesus was doing was so great, it was impossible by man to revive the dead people, to open the blind, right? That's how, if you cannot believe in me, but still you can believe in me, looking at what I am doing in this world. So, you can believe in me. So anyway, here, Jesus is saying that I am the one. Where is it? Verse 26. Then Jesus declared, I who speak to you now am he, the one, Christ. So here, this woman was so happy. Jesus was looked to be a great prophet, but then Jesus was not just a prophet. Even some other religions, they believe in, they also believe somehow about Jesus, but just as a prophet, not as a son of God. You know that religion? Yeah, they believe Jesus as a son of God, but not as Christ. But here, this woman, she met Jesus, firstly, she met Jesus as a prophet, but later, she really met Jesus as Christ. Jesus as Christ. She met. Jesus is the one who would come to this world as Christ. And then Jesus, this man, this Jesus Christ, could save my life, change my life. So she was very happy. She was, my life was changed. So God can change our life. Even though you commit sin today, but don't commit sin intentionally. Don't commit sin intentionally. But because we are here, we can commit sin. But when we are in God, Jesus can save our life. Jesus can still change our life. So this woman, until today, then she was very, what is shameful? She was very shameful, ugly woman, dirty woman in this world. But after she met Jesus, then her whole life totally changed. How? Verse 22. Then, just then, his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman, but no one asked him, what do you want, or why are you talking with her? And maybe Jesus looked to be like, from the normal viewpoint, Jesus didn't look to be good. Why? Jesus was like, talking with her, like, somehow, beautiful woman. Is Jesus just a man? But then nobody was asking Jesus about those. Verse 28. Then, this here, we can find the change of this woman's life. Here. Verse 28. Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people. Yeah, leaving her the water jar. The water jar was her life until today. But then, even the water jar was not so important now. She was so happy because she met Jesus as Christ. You know that, like Bartimaeus, when he was called by Jesus, that he rose up and he threw away his clothes. The clothes was his life. The clothes could protect him from the coldness. But then he left his clothes there, and he jumped, he ran to Jesus.
Jesus. The same. When she met Jesus Christ at 10, she was so happy that she left her waters are there, then she entered the village. And then she says to many people, verse 29, come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ? What is here? Usually, this woman, she was not talking to the people. Usually. Do you think that then she was talking to many people publicly before? she was regarded, many people knew about this woman in the village. That woman, very dirty woman, husband. You need, don't talk with her, okay? Usually the women are threatening their husband. Don't talk with her, okay? And then this woman was regarded as a very dirty woman in the village. And then usually this woman was not talking with anyone. But here, this woman could be proud, would not be shameful anymore, as she could change her life, as she could change her life. So then she started to evangelize here. Verse 29. Come, see, a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ? Yeah, I met Christ. So they came out of the town and made their way towards Jesus. So many people started to believe in Jesus through this woman's evangelism. It was great, great, great woman. Right. Then she was very happy to be saved, to change her life by Jesus. The same, by Jesus Christ, our life could be changed. We need to remember this. By Jesus Christ, we can be protected. By God, we can be protected from all the sin temptations in the world. From all the meaningless things in this world. By the love of God, by the forgiveness of God, we could be saved from this simple world. We need to remember this. And then we can deliver this good news to other people, like this woman. Come and see. I met Jesus Christ. He is the Christ. He saved my life. He changed my life. Please come to our church. Please listen to the word of God. Even God will change your life. We can also talk to many people this way. Come and see. And verse 31. Meanwhile, his disciples urged him, Rabbi, eat something. Here, you know, right? After they are from the journey, then they were hungry. It was almost lunchtime. And then they went out, they entered the town to buy food. Verse 8, right? So that's why all the disciples, they went into the town to buy something. Then while they were not there, while the disciples were not there, then Jesus met a woman. And maybe Jesus was sitting at the well, beside the well, then a woman came to draw water there, then from that time the conversation started. And then she met Jesus as Christ, then Jesus, this woman ran into the town to deliver this good news. And then the disciples came back to Jesus. Before this woman entered and ran into the town, Jesus' disciples came back, and Jesus' disciples looked at Jesus, was talking with the woman,
And then this woman went into the village, and this woman started to deliver this good news. And then the disciples, they brought the food. And they told Jesus, eat something, eat this, rabbi, go, eat food. You are hungry, right? And Jesus was also a man. Jesus was not just a God, spiritual being only. Jesus was also a man. You are hungry. Please eat. We brought some food. Yeah. But then, how did Jesus say? Verse 32. But he says to them, I have food to eat that you know nothing about. What did Jesus say? I have food. I am already full. Huh? Jesus was living with this food. And Jesus was eating the physical food. But then Jesus was living with this joy in God. To be full in God. Full what? Full with what? To save the people. He was so joyful to save one more person. Jesus was so joyful. So we can also live with this joy in God. As we are delivering the word of God, as we are evangelizing one more person, then we can have this joy in God. Yeah. I have the food. I have food in God. Huh? It's not about the physical food. Jesus said the spiritual food. Food with joy, the joy in God. By saving one more person in the world. I have food. Huh? I have food. Huh? That's what I was trying to say. Huh? I have food. Jesus was full. Even before he ate the physical food. I have food. But you do not know. But even for the people, we can know. Huh? When something we are really longing for a long time, when those things are happening, then we can be so joyful. Then even we can feel that fullness. The same, when he save a person, or even when he evangelize a person, even when after we do Bible study, when we teach another person, when we feed another person with the word of God, then even we can feel this joy in God. The servants of God, we can live with this joy. We can enjoy this joy. I have food. My food is what? Verse 33. But still, the disciples, they do not understand. Verse 33. Then his disciples says to each other, Could someone have brought him food already? But no. Jesus was not talking about the physical food. Verse 14. My food, says Jesus, is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish the work of God. Verse 15. Do you not say 4 months more and then the harvest? I tell you, open your eyes and look at the field. They are ripe for harvest. Even now the reaper grows his wages. Even now he harvests the crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. Thus, the saying, one sows and the other, another reaps, is true. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work and you have reaped the benefit of their labor. The workers, harvest, the time of harvest came. So here, we can also read Matthew chapter 9,
Matthew chapter 9 from verse 35. We are almost Matthew chapter 9 from verse 35. Matthew chapter 9 from verse 35 to 38, it says that Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowd, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he says to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the heaven, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." The harvest is ready, the workers are few. What is this talking about? It's not talking about the physical harvest, it's talking about the spiritual harvest. Look at the world, look at the field. The harvest is ready. Many people are waiting for God. Many people need the word of God. Many people need the truth. One need to listen to the true word of God. And then they want to be saved. They need to be changed. They want to be changed. They want to be changed by God with their life. So, this is the heart of God looking at this one. You need to realize this. The harvest is ready, but the workers are few. Jesus said the compassion of them, looking at many people going around, wandering around. This woman was the same. She was going around. She was always thirsty. She was trying to be happy. And then she was trying to find another love. But more painful, more suffering, more pain was covered this woman's life. But then, is this woman met Jesus? This woman's life totally changed. Yeah, totally changed. She got so happy. As she could met Jesus, as she could know the truth. As she could know how she should worship God for her life. Her whole life totally changed. So as we are living, we want to also remember this God's grace. Jesus came to our life to save us. To save us from this simple life, living this life. And then we also want to live like this woman. As she was happy, as she was happy by Jesus to change her life, as she could also deliver this good news to many people, we could also evangelize this way. We don't need to teach them with the doctrines. We don't need to guide. We can guide them with our, what is it? Experience. How we could be God. How God kept my life. Then, we can also deliver this good news. And then, as Jesus was living with this joy, this fullness in God, then we also want to live with this joy. As God is happy, as God saved one more person in the world, and one more sinner from the punishment of God, from the punishment, then we also want to live with this joy, as we can save one more soul. So then, the great joy of God can be overflowing through our life of faith. So we want to end here. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thanks so much for allowing us this time to come before you to make in your word. As Jesus had mercy on the sinners, instead of rebuking this sinner, but Jesus embraced her, forgave this woman. And then, as Jesus taught her, as Jesus wanted to give her your body, your blood, your life to save this woman's life. That's how this woman could be saved by God, could be forgiven by God. This woman could start a new life in God. So we want to also remember this grace of God for our life. God also saved each one of us with the same love for us. And then we want to remember this love of God. And then we also want to continue to live this new life in God. And then we also want to guide others with this joy, with this experience in God. So then, one more sinners, one more people, one more person can be saved, can change their life by your great grace for the Lord. So please be with us. Please guide each one of us continually. So then, even today, you want to remember your grace again. And we want to continue to live with this joy in God through our life. So thank you for your grace through this time. And I pray of this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you very much. God bless you.